folks. Welcome back to the channel. Thank you very much for joining me. You are always most welcome. And today, it's party time. Yes, we have achieved 1 million views on YouTube with my video of the 8 American USAF F-15E Strike Eagles taking off from Lakenheath. Now, we'll come back to that in a second. We're going to talk about F-15s. We are going to have a look at some models. We're going to have some champagne. We've got some nice USA flag, the stars and stripes, and a nice British one in the background. And I was going to have a cigar as well, because I think I deserve it. But don't think I'll actually do that on TV. Might upset the people at YouTube. But more to the point, it's going to fog up the room and the house. So I might have to have that later outside. But that's going to be very sweet victory cigar like Churchill had. Anyway, thank you very much to everyone who's watched this video. Yeah, it's taken 5 years, but it's been a remarkable progress it made, actually. And it's very popular in the last couple of days. All of a sudden, again, I think people start watching it because there's a lot of air shows on, like the Royal International Air Tattoo at Fairford in the UK, for example. But anyway, I think I deserve a drink. I did promise that if I got to the million views, I'd have some champagne, and I jolly well have some, and not just any old champagne, the very finest Tattinger from Reims in France. Now bear with me, because I'm going to try and do this as efficiently as possible. I'm going to open this. I'm also going to get a bit more light on the subject, because we seem to be a little bit in the dark for some reason, so let's just get the lights going. If you just bear with me a second, there we go. Now then. And I need this drink, actually, because here in the UK at the moment we have got temperatures that are just getting frankly ridiculous. In fact, we're going to have, as you watch this, I think you'll be watching this Monday, Tuesday, and it's going to be record temperatures like we've never seen before, so it's getting very, very hot. I'm filming this on Saturday afternoon because I've just hit the million mark. I'll show you that in a second. So, I'm not going to shake it up. It's time for a drink. Ready? 3, 2, 1. Hey, success. I didn't take my eye out or damage the model. Cool. Here we go. I hope you're going to pour yourselves and enjoy a nice drink as well, because I think all those of you that watch the vid do deserve to have a drink, I have to say. And if you're getting these temperatures like I'm getting, you deserve a drink. You'll need it. But don't drink too much. It's not good for you, obviously. Especially when it's this hot. They're quoting 36 degrees centigrade, possibly 40 degrees in parts of the UK. That is 4 degrees higher than we've ever seen. Anyway, that is the real McCoy. I do like this one, it's my favourite. Tattinger from Reims in France, Champagne country. I will now summon my glamorous assistant, who doesn't want to appear on camera sadly, but she's going to take away my bottle and put it in the fridge, I hope, where it'll be nice and safe, and hopefully keep it nice and chilled. If she doesn't drink all of it herself. Yes, she did. I did offer to invite her to come on TV, but she wouldn't have it. Anyway, cheers. Anyway, this is going to be one of the longer vids, I think. So I'm going to sort of take my time. I'm very conscious sometimes. I'm a good English speaker, but sometimes I rush my speaking, public speaking. So I'm going to try and slow down a bit today, because it's that sort of weather. Time to take it easy. Anyway, thank you very much, everyone, for helping me get to 1 million views on YouTube. I believe I'm supposed to get some sort of certificate from them. In the meantime, let's start the video with a nice, cool drink. Cheers, everybody. Thank you very much. Oh yeah, that is good. That is good. So, where to begin? Well, we've got reappearing. These are our old friend, as you see in the background. This is the Revel 1/48th scale Strike Eagle, the E. We'll have a look at that in a minute, another look at it. I've got my Tattinger bottle here and box here in the corner, just to sort of jazz it up a little bit, I thought, for today, as we're having a bit of a celebration. So I'm going to, as I say, I better not smoke that right now, so I'll put that aside. I'm not a smoker as such at all, by the way. So don't be too shocked, to those of you that think I'm a non-smoker, which I am. But when it's special events like birthdays, Christmas, and something really special, I will have a very nice cigar. Now, I like these. That's actually... let's talk about cigars for a moment. This is actually Sharatan. Now, Sharatan are from the Dominican Republic, I believe. If I'm not wrong, I'm sure they are Dominican Republic cigar. And I prefer them to the Cuban ones. I find Cuban cigars are a bit heavy. And I'm not being a regular smoker, you know. As I say, special occasions only. These are kind of sweeter and lighter. So that's the Sharatan. I'll zoom you in, you can have a nosy. And it has this sort of a unicorn motif as their sort of logo. So here we go, the unicorn Sharatan, 1863. Proper cigar, yeah, proper hand rolled, hand produced. Very much in the Cuban style, but just across the water there in the Dominican Republic. Very, very nice, especially if you're not a big cigar smoker. And that is the, is that the Robusto, or is that the, Panatello? I'm trying to remember which version it is. Does smell nice though, it's very nice. Great for a sort of a victory celebration like today. Anyway, I'll put that on one side so it doesn't get damaged. Now, where are we going to start? Let's have a look at a couple of photos to show you, start of all. Yep, 1 million, obviously you know about that now. Let's just zoom in a bit. And let us see what we have here. Oops, that's not so good for starters, is it? Let's just have a look at a couple of pictures. Well, obviously this is the actual YouTube screenshot which I got, which you will notice this was just 20 minutes ago before I filmed this. And you can see here, 1,000,001 views. I was trying to get it on 999999. Well, that proved more elusive. I think that our friends in America must have woken up and decided that they were going to have some views of it, and it just jumped across to 1,000,001. So there you go, there's the proof. So that's the actual video. 8 F-15E Strike Eagles, full afterburner launch, RAF Lakenheath, full HD and sound. That is the video that we're talking about, that I've got so excited about. Or rather, I should say the YouTubers of all, the viewers have got very excited about it. And before we move on, obviously we've got our scene that you see before us, which you're going to talk about more in a minute. A couple of photos, and I was going to talk about my camera. Now, my camera is working right now. But several of you asked me about this a week or two ago. I did one of the videos, I think it was the one on the Sauber Mercedes from Tamiya. People were asking me what the camera was, and they were very impressed by how sharp and clear the pictures was. Well, here we go. So this is the Canon Legria HF-G40. Now, it's not new, it's about 6 years old. But this is the very camera that films all my YouTube vids, and I don't use anything else. And it's also the camera that filmed the F-15s at Lakenheath. So it's quite a multi-function, multi-role camera, capable of lots of things. There it is with the, you can just see today's scene is in the background with the champagne and the flags and the eagle. Anyway, there we go. Thought you'd find that of interest. Now then, one thing I mustn't forget as I'm doing this vid, I hope you'll appreciate that it is jolly warm here in the UK, as I mentioned. So I'm wearing my nice sort of Union flag tie. I wanted to get one that had the stars and stripes on the Union flag together, but I couldn't find one like that. So sorry to our US cousins. I did get you a nice US flag anyway in the background. But this is kind of my Queen's Jubilee tie, if you like, which I thought was quite nice. Makes a change. But whether I'll continue wearing this for very long, it's quite warm, so probably not. Anyway, the other thing I have to check is I have to make sure that I can contact my glamorous assistant if I need more champagne, which I don't know, but I will do shortly. So I'm just going to make sure that I primed her, and I can press a button to demand champagne instantly on demand. I mean, that would be absolutely fantastic, wouldn't it? More champagne, please. Famously went to, with my wife, went to a restaurant and a, it's like a pub and a little hotel, the Maltster's Arms down in Tuckenhay, down in Devon, I think I'm right. And it's not far from, Well, it's the southwest of England, basically. It's where the famous celebrity chef, who I was a big fan of, Keith Floyd, he used to own this place. And there's lots of photographs of him and when he ran it. And he had it for about 12 years, I think. And he did struggle with it, I think, because I think it was quite a lot of work and he couldn't always get the staff he needed and he had a lot of problems. But they've got this room, it's a dining room, and it's a bit like a shrine to him almost, with lots of photographs. And there's actually a button on the wall and it says, which is one of his quotes apparently, "More champagne, please," and it's like a buzzer. You press this buzzer and they rush in another bottle of champagne. So I might need that myself. Anyway, I'm digressing. So, the F-15E Strike Eagle, let's bring over the Reval example here, which I'm sure many of you have probably already seen from me. Is that going to be in the centre? Is that going to be better? Let's just zoom it in and have a quick looky. This is a model I completed Christmas 2019. And I did have quite a few challenges with it, if we're being honest. Not the finest kit ever. But very accurate looking, I think. Quite a lot of cleanup was required. It suffered from flash and some very badly moulded parts, to be honest. And of those, probably the very worst. I'm going to zoom in a little bit more. Try and reposition it for you. Some of the very worst of the mismoulded parts were these actuators here, the actuator rods at the back for the nozzles on the engines. And these are the kit parts, they're not aftermarket. And yeah, we really, really struggled with them. They were very malformed and quite a handful, really, quite a lot of hard work. But in the end, I just had to put in the labour, really, put in the hours to make it work. And I think it came out as a pretty nice eagle in the end. I could have maybe done more with the weathering and things like that, but no, I was very satisfied with it. I think it looks decent, acceptable, as we say. I think I've zoomed in a bit too much, haven't I? Bring you back a bit. There we go. That's it. That's a bit better now. So yeah, and it's got this beautiful instrumentation, which I'm hoping I might be able to show you if I get the angle right. Let's see if I can. Zoom in a bit more here. The instruments are really, really nice, actually. Where I got the green screen, the sort of TFT screens. It came out very well. It's not the greatest, and of course it's been superseded anyway now by the Great Wall Hobby, which is admittedly much more expensive. I mean, Great Wall Hobby's kit is about £80 now, maybe even getting near 90, because they've gone up quite a bit recently. So that's something to bear in mind, and this one was retailing for about £22-23, so you sort of, I suppose you get what you pay for, really. But quite a nice kit. Anyway, I'm digressing a little bit. We have seen that before, but let me talk about the photography, because I did just show the camera. So it's got a 20x optical zoom on this camera. I'm just reading it now off the actual lens as I look at it. And it's got optical zoom. Is, trust me, if you can get a camera with optical zoom and a quality lens, and it's all about the lens, really. If you can get that, then you're onto something like Nikon or Canon, something of that nature. That's Leica lenses. They're really excellent as well. But you need a fantastic quality multi-element lens, electronic zoom, digital zoom, as they call it. But you're not really zooming at all. All you're doing is widening the pixels. You're just stretching them, and it doesn't give you any more clarity, unfortunately. So you really need to get yourself a proper camera if you're going to do a lot of sort of air shows and things like that. And I see people posting on YouTube a lot of things, including Lakenheath, and I'll talk about that specifically. And they're not very good at it, some of these people. I'm not trying to be critical of others. Please don't misunderstand me. But I look at them and I know there's two problems. One is the camera, the other one is the operator. and the two issues boil down to the filming it on your camera phone. No, you're not going to... Yes, you'll get a... Yes, it's an eagle. But you're never going to get a really high quality video image unless you've got something that's a very high-end SLR or a camcorder like this one. And I prefer the camcorders because they are specific for that purpose. SLRs are better at still photography, I think. And there are some very fine ones that are good at video, don't get me wrong, but you're compromising, aren't you, a little bit? It's not really been intended as a video camera originally. I know there's a lot of hybrids as well. I think you should let things do what they're intended to do. So that's the camera I use. There are newer versions of it out. I've always been a big fan of Canon lenses. But others are available, you know, and I've seen one or two videos on YouTube at Lakenheath. So this is useful to talk about as a back-to-back comparison. And I've seen them and they are really, really good. But the ones that were really good, most of them were actually filmed on the base by some of the Lakenheath team themselves, the 48th Fighter Wing, I'm sure of it, or visitors. Because you can tell that they've got access that the rest of us can't get. And most of the other videos, and this is why this video that I've got the million views for was shot. I never imagined we'd be having this sort of video that I'd achieve a million views or even 100,000 views. And the reason I shot it was I love the subject matter, obviously. But I watched so many people doing it so badly. I think the problems fall into two categories. Obviously the camera is 50% of the battle. But even those that have got good cameras, they can't quite decide. I think it's a skill in photography, action photography. It's not the same as anything else. Same in motor racing, actually. You've got to decide what is the target. And not just what is the target that you're taking the pictures of, or the footage of, I should say. But what is the specific target that you most want to show in that frame. So what I was most wanting to show was the F100 engine nozzles, basically. That was the target. And if you watch that video closely, you'll see exactly what I mean. That is very much the focus, quite literally and metaphorically as well. But it's not easy when you've got eight of those aircraft blasting off as they were in that vid. Even I didn't get it perfect. I was getting close, but not perfect. Especially toward the end, when you start becoming punch drunk, it's almost like fighting Mike Tyson a little bit with those guys, because they're roaring off. The ground is shaking, your body's shaking. It's like being in the middle of a thunderstorm. And it's quite scary. I was quite frightened, actually. It's like, oh my God, you know. And this gets to people. And it did get to me. It started to get to me. If you look at the very last aircraft, when I zoom back, first of all, he takes off much quicker, rather dangerously quicker, I thought, but maybe not. I thought he was taking off far too soon relative to the penultimate one, the seventh one. I think it's 316 and 315. 315 tail number is the last one, and he just roared straight after the other one. So much so that I didn't have chance to see his nozzles operate on the engines. And you see me sort of overpan and have to come back again. I sort of go whoop whoop, and that is just the sheer lack of gap between the two aircraft. So it's not easy. Some other elements that can count in your favour or against you as well are, well, sheer luck, really, the weather, the light. I was very lucky that day. One of the reasons that I said that I'd sort of deliberately planned to make that video, never to be the success it is, but I just wanted to make a really nice video of them taking off there. And I felt that other people just weren't, they were panning back and forth and couldn't decide whether to show one taking off. And some of them are just tragic, to be honest. It's like the back and forth, they don't know what to focus on, and before you know it, they've all gone. It's all a complete disaster. And without being critical of the individuals who filmed it, it's so easy to get into that situation because your brain can't keep up. There's so much happening at once. And it's a bit like, you know, Grand Prix racing or something like the Indy 500. It's full on action, you know. So it's not easy. And I kind of literally wasn't trying to, I'm not trying to big myself up here, but I literally watched other people's and I thought, by watching five or six different approaches, I thought, you've all got it wrong, but each one had got something right, you know. And what I tried to do in my mind is plan how to take these aircraft in a way that would try and reduce those errors. And combine perhaps the six different styles I'd seen into one video. So I decided not to show the aircraft. Once it lifts off, I cut straight back to the next one, because I know that you have no time to do anything else. If you don't do that, you'll lose it, because it will all ready to be running down the runway, and you won't know where it is. So that's really difficult, you know. So I think that what you do is you do what I did, and then you focus on the final one, then you show its full takeoff, leaving the area right the way out of frame, and it worked really well. So I would say to you, if you're going to film multiple planes taking off, Red Arrows is another example, try and do it like that. You'll never take, unless they all take off en masse, which I think the Red Arrows do sometimes, don't they? Then you're never going to be able to get them all in. So just focus on the last ones, because you have to make that choice. It's either going to be the first ones, but then trying to get your focus back and realise where the other aircraft are is almost impossible. Very, very difficult. Anyway, a few tips for you there. But the other thing as well is, some of you will have seen my other videos that are shot on the phone, and those are because I keep getting things like the Avro Anson that flies over our house, one or two other, we have a yak. Last week, to prove that I'm not perfect either at all, we had a Spitfire, we had a Thunderbolt P-47, the only one that's based at Duxford, and we also had the Mustang that's based at Duxford, and they all flew over and I didn't capture any of them because I just wasn't quick enough. And that's another challenge, you know, if you're not expecting them, I suppose it's quite tough, you know. I could have actually got the tail end of the Spitfire, but it was just a dot in the distance by the time. It would have been worth doing. Anyway, there we go. I'm sort of going on about photography here, but I just thought it was interesting to share with people. But try and get yourself in a good spot. Try and I said that I was lucky with that, the successful vid I've got. And the main element of luck was the wind direction and the weather. The wind direction is almost blowing, it's just blowing to my left a little bit, probably blowing to the due west, I think. But it was, most of the sound was coming straight toward the microphone, so this is why it sounds so good. And it was a breeze, not a wind, so it just sounds perfect, you know. The crackles of the engines are really clear, and that was the main reason it came out so well, really. That and the fact that I went there actually the night before. It's a funny story, actually. I'm just gonna have a drink. It's quite a funny story. Cheers to all of you again. I was actually on a business trip and I went down and took the camera because I knew I was passing Lakenheath. So I actually took the footage. If you look at the link at the end of the video, and I'll put it up here, the big video, so you can watch it again, the million views video. But at the end of that, it's only 3.5 minutes. And right at the end, I've got other links. And the other link at the bottom right one, that was actually the night before. And I was kind of practicing the night before, but not really knowing that I'd have any opportunity to take any more because I was on a business trip. The next day I had business commitments. Well, I was very lucky because the business commitment I had, which was about 60 miles away, was with a company. And we had a lady flying in from one of the companies that I work for. They had a site in Germany. And the technical boss from Germany was coming in to see a customer to give technical advice. And her flight was delayed by about 90 minutes. And I got this phone call saying the flight's delayed by 90 minutes, you can just, you know, have another coffee or whatever. Well, when I got this call, I was actually just approaching Lakenheath. I intended to just stop for 2 minutes and drive on. Well, of course, I was able to stop for 90 minutes. So I did, and that's when I captured it, and that's why it was, like, it was about 9 o'clock in the Wednesday morning, I think it was, in April 2017. So again, luck, you know, luck plays a part in it. And I have been to Lakenheath 3 or 4 times and I've been very unsuccessful previously. And I've also been up to the mountains in Wales to the Mac Loop. And the loop that goes around to McKinleth. And I've been very unlucky again, because every time I go, it's guaranteed nothing's going to turn up at all. And I've been on days when you would expect them and there's been hundreds of people on the hills, all disappointed just like me. So all the planets aligned on this particular day, and I say the light was right, the weather was right, the wind was right, circumstances allowed me to be there by fluke, sheer chance, and that was it, really. So, you know, it's like anything in life, I think luck plays quite a big role in it sometimes. Anyway, there we go. So photography, yeah, my advice is to take a deep breath, take your time, decide in your mind how you want the final video to look and which part of the viewer's eye, what you want them to be looking at in that shot. And as I say, I focused on the engines and I think it worked pretty well, really. But there we go. I'd be very surprised if I get another video that gets a million views, I think that these things come along once in a lifetime. I mean, I say that, there's plenty of people on YouTube with a million or 5 million views, but there are always things that are, I think, slightly misleading, clickbait, or they are a news event or something terrible, like a tragedy or like the war in Ukraine or whatever, something really bad, or a cat doing something amusing, or a dog, you know, something that's kind of a fluke, or something that's very newsworthy. Well, this wasn't any of those things. This was a deliberate short video, 3.5 minutes. I think it's popular because I just did it well, really. Vanity is a very, very serious flaw. What am I saying? But I did well, didn't I? I did well. Yeah, I could probably go there 100 times and never do it as well again. That's the truth of it. So, yeah, luck definitely came into it, you know. My champagne's warming up quicker than normal. Gosh, your tank's warm. Anyway, let's crack on. Now, I want to say a big hello, welcome to our American cousins. I think we should treat this as a bit of a party, to be honest. Now, of course, when our American friends, and there's many of you in the States, Canada, and even South America. And of course, when you guys tune in, it's usually kind of lunchtime or early afternoon when I regularly do my model-related videos. Because I tend to put them on at 8 p.m. UK time, so correct me if I'm wrong, I think it's, we have one viewer, she's over in Seattle, so that's noon in Seattle, and then in New York, is it about mid-afternoon, about 3 p.m? 3 p.m. I think. It's sort of 7 hours behind, 2 p.m. aren't it? 7 hours behind? Or is it five? No, five hours behind, aren't you? So about 4 p.m. So basically, it spans the whole afternoon across the United States, doesn't it? And I know that, just before I finish actually and talk about the models, I know that this video, this million views video, one of the reasons it's been very successful, I don't know the exact details, but I'm pretty confident that it was shared. Nothing to do with me. I am not on social media in any form whatsoever. I don't do Facebook, Twitter, I don't do Instagram, I don't do anything. The only place you can find me on is here on YouTube. I'm not a blogger, I'm not a vlogger, I'm not an influencer. I hate that word, it's awful. People that say, I'm an influencer, good God, what are they talking about? Such nonsense. I'm none of those things, I'm just someone who's very passionate about a couple of subjects. Aviation in particular, and modelling, really, those are the main ones, and motor racing as well, if I'm honest. So, and history, so that's kind of four subjects, if you like. And I just want to share that passion with other people. I'm not trying to influence anybody. I know that I give ratings on these models, but they are subjective. They're my opinions, you know. But most of you seem to agree. I don't think I've ever got a rating where most of you have disagreed. I think the odd one has thought I've been harsh or a bit generous sometimes. But never, I don't think I've ever been far out, you know. I think it's useful to give them a rating as well. And I like to rate them of their time and of their price. So we don't really compare a Matchbox kit from 72 to, you know, the new Rebel F-15 here. You couldn't compare those. It's not reasonable. So when I give the rating, it's really based on what we would expect for that money at that time. So think of it like that. Don't think that I'm comparing everything and giving it a ranking. It's just, you couldn't do that. It's like they talk about motor racing, about, you know, ranking Stirling Moss and Ayrton Senna and Jim Clark and Lewis Hamilton. Well, you can't do that because it's impossible. You'll never really get a true answer. So it's the same with this, really. I think that it's just useful. It's just useful to put it in its perspective. I mean, for example, recently we had the Frog kits, and I've been really down on Frog. I've said how awful they are. But I did have a couple of really terrible ones. I think I had some of the really early ones. I think I had maybe a Tempest and a Mark 9 Spitfire, and I think there were some of the very early molds they did, and they weren't good. They were not good. And then Matchbox came out, and to me that was it. I never bought another Frog kit, never touched them at all. So, you know, I just realised, by the way, that my watch has spun round. By the way, I'm digressing now. I put a different one on today. I thought, because of the Stars and Stripes and the UK sort of, you know, the special relationship, I thought I'd put on something that kind of looked a bit UK stroke USA. Nice red, white and blue watch, but there we go. Anyway, Yeah, so we're not ranking them compared to today. I mean, today, you know, I've given some fairly lukewarm receptions to some new kits that are beautifully moulded, but I've been very disappointed with the overall presentation. So, you know, especially the instructions or the lack of dioramas or stands and things like that. And I just don't think enough effort goes into that today. I think manufacturers think they can just pump out a load of stuff, make sure that the moulding is perfect, and then just don't bother with the rest. Well, I don't buy that. I don't buy that. Anyway, I'm sure that most of you that enjoy this channel are basically like-minded to me in most respects on these subjects, but, you know, we have our little beefs. We don't like the revising of history and the, you know, the imprinting of modern values on historical subjects, and that's just ridiculous as well. That's a bit like what we just talked about, trying to compare things from bygone years to today. It's impossible. And we, you know, we don't like some of the other things that have been done with the way that, I mean, we've got Revo in front of us, of course. I don't like the way they do their boxes. And we did talk about this the other week, didn't we? I did the review on this, which got a very good review, didn't it? 9.5, I think I gave it. It got a good rating because it's cheap, this kit, and it's a nice kit. But I didn't like this. I thought that, and several of you have written to me in the comments and said, yeah, it's shocking, shouldn't be allowed. I mean, that doesn't represent anything. It's just a very poor early render that is shockingly bad. And that does smack of this sort of Chinese approach, I think, of which they often do. Great Wall Hobby do it, don't they, and others. Where they can't be bothered getting anybody to even build the model, which is what Revell have always done. They've always had a finished model. Now, in years gone by, some of those have been very, very poor. But recently, in the last 2-3 years, there have been some really good ones. They've really made more effort. This is a trend they need to drop right now, because that's the one thing on this that I hate. I think it's absolutely awful. Anyway, speaking of Revell, I wanted to also talk about this kit and talk about the new kit. And we've got a couple of lovely books to show you, which I think are very relevant. And our American buddies who love their eagles will find both of these of interest. We've got one here, which I think is a UK, it kind of looks an American style, but I think it's a UK publication, and the Air Data one I think is as well, from Sam. Yes, printed in the UK. So, what does it say here? So I thought we'd have a little flick through those. But first, look, before I move it for its own protection, the Strike Eagle here, I thought we'd talk about it. Here I have Revell's instructions for what was a fairly average kit, if I'm really being honest. Many of you will have built this, I'm sure. And as I say, it wasn't so much its shape. Things like the accuracy I thought were very good. It was the way that they had gone about fabricating it, which let them down. I mean, for example, the flash. I got two of these, by the way. I think several others did as well. Several people got more than one of these top fuselages. And then, you can see I built the kit. Somebody was very rude to me the other day, by the way. I'm going to complain now. I'm not going to name him because he wasn't a regular viewer or subscriber. And he just said, are you ever going to build any of these kits? So instead of just rambling on about them, you clearly have, how did he put it? He said, you clearly have no idea how to build one. Okay. Okay. And I wrote back and I just said, well, if you actually look, if you bother to take the time before making a comment like that, perhaps you should just check if there are any that have built, and if there's any photos or videos. Now, I don't do build videos for two reasons. One, I'm afraid, to my deep sorrow and embarrassment, I have no idea how to edit. So it would be just one long cut, which is why all my videos are in a single take. Everything is a single take. So you can see that things like the Battle of Britain and Steve McQueen, they're 90 minutes without a break. There is no cuts in it whatsoever. Everything is done from memory or presenting something in front of us like this. Anyway, the point is that, of course, I've got lots and lots of builds, and they are on YouTube, many of them in the last 4 or 5 years, with tons of photographs. And I usually do it as a photo montage. And you can see me hard at it, and here you can see I've been hard at it because I've gone and got some blooming paint on the actual instructions. Anyway, one of the things that annoys me about the old Revell is that they have got this habit of only quoting their own paints, which is very, very useless. we had a bit of a lack of detail, but they did make up for it with some decals, which were quite good in the cockpit area, actually. And things like these TFT screens, the consoles. And when I was building this kit, I got to about here, and I was thinking, oh, it's going all right. It's not. And then we got to here, and then it all started to go horribly wrong. Especially this part, just beneath where my thumb is. These are those actuator nozzle rods, which I just mentioned when I showed you the kit. And they are horribly misfigured, these. And there are how many of them? 15 on each one, so that's 30 of those. All mismoulded, short shots, you name it, absolutely terrible. Also, by the way, we've also got the Great Wall hobby disease going on here, because we seem to have instructions where you've got to sort of assemble the instructions. They're all just in sheet form. They are relatively logically done, but it would help if they could put a staple in the instructions. Time for a drink. Excuse me. Oh yeah, that hits the spot, I tell you. I fear that as you're watching this, you and I, those of us in the UK certainly, and some of you in the States, maybe even worse, we're going to be burning up while watching this. I can almost feel you sweating. In fact, I've got a little fan I was going to use, but it's a bit noisy, so I decided not to bother. And I wanted to shoot this video. Today is Saturday. I'm shooting. Simply because I looked at the temperatures and I thought, there is no way I can wear a tie or a jacket or, frankly, any clothes. No. But you know, I didn't want to sort of be sitting here sweating, pouring in sweat, because I think we're all going to be in that situation. So by the time we are watching this, chatting away to each other on live chat, when we have this party, live chat party on Monday, I think it'll be, we're going to be right in the middle of this firestorm. And they say people are going to die. They reckon that you know, if people haven't got, they're in tower blocks, or if you haven't got air conditioning, or you haven't got many windows, you know, there's a real risk of personal health and risk of death even, because it's going to be so extreme. This is going to be like California, sort of New Mexico sort of conditions, or worse really. Maybe even Saharan Africa or the Atacama Desert or somewhere like that. It's going to be very extreme. I mean, I'm not exaggerating. They have said it's going to be 4 degrees hotter than the hottest summer we've ever had for 2 days. So I'm going to be, don't know about you guys, but as you are listening to me talk, it's going to be Monday night and we are going to be right in the middle of this firestorm like a volcano. So have a drink, keep yourself hydrated. Not too much alcohol though, yeah? Try to stay cool. Tell you what, one thing that we have done, my wife and I, neither of us likes the heat. We've got it's like a bungalow style, so it's like a house that's got no upstairs, but it has got an upstairs. But it's quite shallow, but it's not a multi-storey building. But it gives, because of the design, the upstairs bedrooms are kind of in the attic, in the loft. So that makes it very warm. So we just gave up and decided to buy an air conditioning unit, a portable one, about 18 months ago. And we only very rarely use it for these extreme conditions, but we have not regretted it, I can tell you. Because it means we can just seal the bedroom off, the main bedroom, which is a fair size. And we can make it like a really cool, proper, chilled room. And then the minute you walk out, you know, into the landing area, oh, it's like walking into an oven. And I think as we speak, as you're watching me say these words, and we're chatting about my, you know, I'm sure you'll be commenting yourselves, well, those conditions will be ferocious, I think, as we're talking here. Monday evening and Tuesday daytime are supposed to be absolutely horrendous. 40 degrees C in the UK. Now, many of you will be watching this, you know, if you're in South Africa or something, you'll be thinking, God, or Australia, you know, you'll be thinking, Struth, who's this Sheila, you know? Because you're used to it, but we're just not. We have cold, wet weather, even summers here. So, you know, I'm not moaning about it. I'm just saying that. But this is exceptional. These are record temperatures in the UK. Anyway, we'll try to continue. I'm just glad I'm filming it now and I'm not actually doing a live broadcast Monday or Tuesday, because that would have been... I did consider that, but that was just impossible. Anyway, let's go on talking about the Strike Eagle and having another drink. So we've got our lantern pods here. This is where they did it rather well in this kit, I thought. Got your lantern pod, and you've got your sidewinders and your big tanks here. They all did this very nicely. One thing they didn't do very nicely was the join there. We had this horrible... I did talk about this with the new kit. It's got the same idea of having the modular nose, which I'm not really keen on. But at least on the new kit, they didn't have a seam down the middle. They had a separate nose, like a slide-moulded design. So they did that quite well. These are nasty, I've got to be honest. I'm hoping in the new design that we've seen will be much better than this. This is very crudely done. Nothing fitted well, you know. We ended up with, and here it goes when you're trying to assemble it near the end. So we ended up with big gaps here. Didn't mate up well at all. And we had problems over on the other side. Here, when we're doing the intakes, it's the old story with jets. Big intake issues. Really difficult stuff, yeah. So that was a problem. And then you got the CFT, the conformal fuel tanks, on the side. They didn't fit very well. There was a bit of filler needed. It just didn't go together very well. It wasn't absolutely tragic, but it was not fun. A lot of messing about. They did this well. Some things they did really well, like the air brake. They did that really well. This they didn't do so well. So they had a canopy that had a horrible seam right down the middle of it. Right down the centre it has this seam, and it was a really deep one, a real nightmare to get rid of. So I had very mixed views about it, to be honest. And however, you know, I'm complaining here, but the actual final result doesn't look too bad, does it? It's not too shabby. It looks very, very nice in my cabinet, I have to say. And look at that, stars and stripes behind it. It looks absolutely brilliant, doesn't it, really? I shouldn't complain too much, I suppose. It just requires so much effort, though. And I think you get to a point in your life where you're thinking, I'm not prepared to put that in, really. It's just not worth it. I'd rather spend another £20-30 on a kit that goes together nicely. But time to start moaning about Revell, because at the end of the day, the 72nd scale one here does seem to have cured quite a few, we hope. So it looks like they've cured a lot of those silly faults, and it is a very nice kit. And what I'm going to do, have a very brief look at it, just pointing out, those bubbles are making me I'm just pointing out the one or two areas that they've really improved it on. So what I'm going to do, if you will allow me, I will move the Strike Eagle out of the way, just over here. Try not to knock it. We'll have a look at these books in a second, because I think you'll really find these interesting. Well, let's just have a very quick, I'm not going to do another review because I've done it already, but just want to draw your attention to one or two things that we did that were really, really cool. I think you'll enjoy it. Don't forget to have another drink, yeah, because I can almost feel people sweating and I can hear their fans going and wafting themselves and saying, this is too hot, Pete, hurry up. But I thought I'd entertain you, you know, because there's nothing better really than if you've got such extreme conditions and just going into a dark room and watching a bit of YouTube, is that really? And having a nice cool drink. I'm getting a bit low, I might have to press that button and summon my glamorous assistant in a moment. I did offer to have her on the video. She would have none of it. And I was thinking, I was secretly thinking, this could be the only chance I've got to get another million views on YouTube. But she said no. It wasn't to be, I'm afraid. I will just finish this, if you excuse me 1 second, and then I'll summon some more in a minute. I need to finish it because it's gone warm. That tells you how hot it is, because it's really... it's baking and it's making the drink go warm quickly. Anyway, so back to our Revell new type Strike Eagle. Those of you that missed the review, I'll tell you something, it's a real cracker list. They've done some lovely bits. I mentioned about the change of approach where they've gone and done this nose, which is like a slide moulded nose. Can you see it there right in the middle? So they've really thought it through with a proper, you know, Tamiya style, if you like. But they've also got some clever ideas here where they've gone for, instead of having those hideous intakes that are on the 48 scale, here they've done a really nice job of it, and they've actually built like a wing spar, all in basically as like a unitary modular construction, and it really looks like it's going to work well. We've also got a nice solid sprue here that seems really well put together. We've got some beautiful detail. Look at the underside of this fuselage. It's absolutely stunning, the detail. So fine, the panel lines. All the little latches and hatches. The APU exhaust, auxiliary power unit exhaust underneath, etc. So nicely done. Really impressed with it. And then we've got on the other side, we've got the, again, some really beautiful parts here where we've got the wing, top wing, and again, fantastic detail. Fine sort of engraving in the panel lines. They didn't have, the only disappointment is they didn't have, as with the 48 scale, no chance of having any ailerons or flaps moving or positionable, which I was a bit disappointed about. It's the only thing that sort of annoyed me, but the quality, I'd rather take the quality over sort of gimmicks, you know. And then the rest of it is kind of much and muchness, I suppose, really. So I won't go through any more of that, but I thought I'd show you those two things because they were some of the standout parts of this kit and one of the reasons that I was so very impressed. Let's get that back in there. Now, there we are. So, zoom you out a bit so you can see what the hell's going on. No more green screen. We don't need any of that, do we? I'm not rushing through this at my usual pace because I haven't got any pace today. I don't think any of us have we? It's taken its toll, isn't it? Times like this when you look forward to Christmas. How many of you, by the way, are having the same problem with your modelling mojo? I'm going to talk about that near the end, actually, because I've got, I don't know if you noticed, I've got my my Porsche 917, that's the Steve McQueen Le Mans Porsche from the movie. I haven't made any progress on that. Well, I haven't made progress on any kits, and that's the sad thing, really. I've had the, I'm going to moan about my health problems. I've got this arm now, it's become a shoulder problem as well on the right shoulder. Give me a lot of problems, and I've had to see the doctor again this week. Anyway. But it isn't helped by the weather. Actually, my symptoms are actually slightly improved by the weather, but it's, I promise you, it's only the weather. But as the weather cools down and we head towards the autumn, I mean, I just don't have any. I mean, that's a physical problem I've been moaning about all year, since mid-January. But putting that aside, I was very keen, personally, this year to do these Falklands. I'm really interested in the Falklands War. It's a real hobby, and a hobby horse, you might say. Keen interest I have. And I was planning to do these. I've got the HMS Invincible. What's it, Sheffield? HMS Invincible, the aircraft carrier. Through deck cruiser. I've got the Sea Harrier, which as you've seen repeatedly over my shoulder. I've got some fantastic kits. I've got the TACOM Sea Dart Sea Wolf system, the rocket system, the anti-aircraft. I've got some amazing subjects from the Falklands, and I am really keen to do them. But A, I've had this physical problem, and B, since that stopped me initially, but in the last few weeks I've just got no mojo at all to build kits. I just can't be bothered. Don't want to be spraying when it's very hot and, you know, stinking the house out with solvents, and I just can't motivate myself. But I promise you, and I'm sure many of you are the same, the minute we get to sort of September, October, it's all I can think about. I suddenly just switch on like a light bulb and I become obsessed with modelling, and that's when the progress will be made. Every year my most productive time has been the run-up to Christmas, basically. Between sort of October and Christmas, that's when I make the most models. That's when I enjoy it the most. Is that bulging so much? It's very bulgy. I enjoy it the most in those colder, darker, you know, winter nights. There's nothing on telly, TV, you know. And you've got, when you've got such a wonderful stash, as many of you will have, like me. I've made a mess of that, haven't I? I've not done that well at all. Anyway. That's the time I enjoy my model making the most. And this is all the great models I've made have been made then. Messerschmitt 163B Comet, Mustang, Spitfire, this, Mirage, Tiger Tank, Thunderbolt. They've all been made in the autumn, sort of winter. All the best ones, really. So, yeah, I kind of look forward to some cooler weather. I'm sure you do too. Anyway, let's move. That's a great kit. That's about that retails for about £30 approximately in the UK. £25 to £30. £30, I think, is the going rate. I haven't decided what to do with this yet. I was even going to, as a part of my party, to celebrate my million views. I was actually thinking I might auction this for charity. I mean, we've just had, I won't name names, but one of the regular subscribers and viewers on the channel, who I know from another forum as well, actually bid on the Ghost of Kiev, and he bid a really good price, and I kind of felt bad, but it was for charity, all of it, every penny. I got nothing apart from the postage. So I actually threw in some extras for him. I put extras in, saying if it got over £40, I'd put extras in. And I won't quote the numbers, but it was more than that. And I gave him some extras again. And it was really great, because he got into the spirit of it. And two or three of you did. And you know who you are. So thank you. And some of you are the same people that also lend me kits and things, you know. So it went really well. And that's all gone to Ukraine. And God knows they need it, you know. So I was thinking with this, I technically don't really need this as a finished kit. I can't decide whether to... this is where I'd like your input, please. Should I donate it to charity? Should I send it to Models for Heroes? Should I do another Ukraine, perhaps for the Ukraine, and generate some more? And if I do, I'll probably again throw in some extras. So I'll probably throw in, maybe not both of these, but certainly this one. I know how to, that was really hard to get hold of. But this is a cracking, but we'll look at it in a minute. But I'm thinking I might do a twin pack and maybe do another purely charitable thing, so I get nothing from it. And maybe we could raise, again, another 30, 40, 50 pounds, something like that, who knows. All for the best of causes at the moment, people that need our help. But what do you think? Another option was to maybe give it to one of my subscribers as a gift. The problem I've got there is it's really hard under what circumstances to choose who to give it to. That gives me a problem, and I don't want to be seen to be favouring one over another. So many of you, you know, I can, you know the names, I can reel them off, you know. So many of you, and dozens of you now, have helped me with this channel and given me material. One guy in particular, I did think of giving it to him, because he always gives me a lot of written documentation, makes a real effort into it. It's difficult. I don't know what to do. What I am throwing this over to you. What should I do? Seriously, especially in the live chat, should I give this to one of you? But how would I decide who to give it to? That's the first question. Or should I do a charitable donation and make it quite attractive by putting this in there, you know, and I think it would see. It just feels like I should make an effort. Having got this million views, I should make some sort of contribution, or what's the word I'm looking for? To commemorate it, a commemorative event. We can use this as collateral. It's worth at least £30. This is, well, it's £8, so that's £38 straight away. Now, if we went and put it to charity, especially for a worthy cause, we might get a little bit more than that. I would hope so. Been reviewed by me, and it's all, none of it's been touched with my bare hands, as you know. This is why I've got the gloves on yet again, and I'm handling models, and I'm very sweaty, which doesn't help. But what do you think? Please comment. I'm quite serious. You know, I'm prepared to give that and that away to celebrate my victory in getting a million views, and I'd like it to be to a worthy cause. Several of you, as I say, without going into the names, but you know who you are, that have helped me along in recent months especially. And I'd be very, very willing to give that up and send it to one of you. But I don't want to feel that I am favouring one over the other. It becomes difficult, doesn't it? Or I say I could give it to Models for Heroes, another very worthy charity, where generally UK servicemen who have fought in places like Afghanistan, etc., and have a lot of physical and mental health problems, and something like that, a nice new spanking kit would be very enjoyable for them to build. And there's also American charities. I was looking at one, is it the AFAS, the American Forces Air Service Charity, I think it is. Another charity. And again, I'd be prepared to maybe, I was going to say sell it on eBay, but eBay's really weird actually with charities. Excuse me. They're quite strange. They only have a very sort of limited number of charities instead of, you know, very restrictive actually. I mean, I could ask people to... It's more difficult when you go on eBay, though, because it's not just amongst the people that are watching this video, unfortunately. But I would be prepared to do that and give it to an American Forces charity. I'm open-minded, but I think I'm going to give this away, and this magazine, which I'll show you in a second, to make it more meaningful, which is a really useful resource. I think I'm going to probably contribute those for you to enjoy, and either I'll make a donation or do it via charity. Tell me what you think. Anyway, without further ado, I'm going to move the striking. I'm really worried that I'm going to knock this in a minute and knock it flying. So it's the old story, isn't it? We've got to be very, very careful with them. Move it out. So say goodbye to the F-15E Strike Eagle for now. I'm going to pop it out of shot over there. Hopefully where it won't come to any trouble. It's a little bit delicate on its undercarriage, if I'm honest. Another one of the areas that Ravel didn't do such a good job of. So I'll move that. So please bear in mind what I've said. To commemorate my great success with this video, I've talked about linkable. I'm going to give this away either to charity or to one of the subscribers. But please tell me which you think would be the most sensible option. I'm very interested to hear what you've got to say. So that's that. Let's have a look at this material that we haven't seen before. I'm going to zoom you in. More champagne, please. This is supposed to be a party. Come on. I know it's very hot. And it is plumbing hot, I tell you. And this is... I'm speaking to you probably 48 hours before you're going to... I've just dropped the champagne. And it's gone everywhere. And it's made a bit of a mess. I shall have to have more champagne. Definitely need more champagne now. Fell off the edge. And I think I broke the glass as well. Oh, dear. These things, this is live TV, you see, live TV. Let me just get a little cloth. You'll have to bear with me, this is quite funny, isn't it? You're going to think he's raving drunk. He's drunk. So it's just the heat came to me. But that actually fell then, slipped, and it had a little bit of a spin. Spilled some of its champagne, and then it fell on the ground, and it shattered everywhere. And we had a bit of a tragedy. I shall just request a new glass while we're at it, because that one's... We can't say it's not shot live now, can you? We had a little bit of a problem. A new glass? Yes, because unfortunately we've had a bit of a tragedy. It's okay. Thank you. Oh, my assistant never lets me down. Look at that. As if by magic, another one appears. Well, I deserved a slap for that, really, and she was very nice about it, wasn't she? Look at that. So, what I did wrong was I just put it right on the edge, and that is always dangerous, isn't it? Always. And we've got glass all over the blooming place. Luckily, it doesn't seem to have affected the kit. It did splash on it, but thanks to Ravel's very glossy box, it's just like water off a duck's back, quite literally. It's just sort of shrugged its shoulders. Did we get any on the model? That's the slight concern. Bear with me a second, folks, because we have got a little bit of a practical problem here. Did we get any on the model? Did we get away with it? Do you know? By God, I think we got away with it. We didn't get any on the F-15E. I just moved it out. 6 inches far enough.
Wow. I mean, that is remarkable, really. I knew that having champagne was dangerous. Ah, dear, oh dear. Right, I'll be back with you in a moment. Giving you a good laugh. We know we made a good chuckle, don't we? Pop that in there, in the bin, and the glass. Bit more of the old tissue. Good job I've got my modelling tissues to hand. It was just teetering on the edge, that was the problem. Just didn't quite get it as it started to go. Had I drunk more of it, it would have been less of a problem. It's the glass that worries me most. Yeah, that glass, it didn't shatter the way you might imagine it would. Which is a good thing. It's a good job my wife very kindly actually came with another glass. Now she didn't know. She didn't know that I'd just done that. Because she hadn't had a chance to hear the story. What I did do to get it on the iPad? I hope not. I got some of it on the the old instructions, but I think the iPad survived okay. Wow, well, we were very fortunate all around there. Are we okay? We're not going in the gloves? We're good, good to go. Ah, boy, these things are sent to tryers, aren't they? Actually, that was a miracle because that could have been an absolute train crash. It could have destroyed the model, it could have destroyed the kit, and it hasn't. We've got away with it on so many levels, it's unreal, really. It's just a fluky, lucky escape. Yeah, no problem. It's not the other one over. I know what you're thinking. You're all placing bets saying he's going to knock the other one over and smash that as well. Now, anybody else would have said, cut, we'll reshoot it, open another bottle of champagne, we'll take it from the top. No. Keep it over there, it's safe. Alright, still got a bit under there. Tell you what we have got. I have, handily, I've got wet wipes. And I think they'll come in handy here. So let's just put some of them under. There we go. Sorry about this. Talk amongst yourselves. Enjoy a drink. Make sure you don't spill yours. I just can't believe it didn't really shatter. It broke, but it didn't shatter. And normally, you would expect that they would. I thought that was going to be an absolute disaster. I've got to do this because it's such a damn mess. It's going to be sticky all over the place. It's the stickiest thing in the world, isn't it, champagne? Well, something new to entertain you. Nothing like a bit of live comedy. Slapstick, Laurel and Hardy, you know the style. Just missed the F-15 model, I can't believe that. There's a couple of shards of glass. Just have to remove those for safety reasons, really. Now, that was Phil Flory, he'd just shout, cut, and there'd be technical difficulties, time would come up. I think he does that quite well, it's quite funny, isn't it? Right, let's make sure I've got no shards of glass sticking through my gloves. I'll have to have a jolly old clean up later on, I suppose. Right. No, I think we're good to go. Make sure the hands are dry before we tackle the magazine. Oh dear, oh dear, oh dear. Roll on Christmas. I think it's just starting, the heat is starting to get to you a little bit, isn't it? It just gets a bit too much. I'm talking to Gary Hyder. I hope you're on tonight, Gary. And he's another one like me. He doesn't like the heat at all. He was really complaining about it, and I thought, man, I'm with you. I know exactly where you're coming from. I can't stand it, and that's why I bought this portable air conditioning unit. And we bought it at New Year when it was dirt cheap. I think paid about. Well, it wasn't cheap, it was about £400. But I think they're normally £550, £600, you know. So, quite a good investment now. Quite a good investment, to be honest. Anyway, cheers. Mmm. Right, are we good to go yet? I think we are. Let's make sure these hands are dry before we... Everything's sort of sticking up and locking up and heating up. It's all getting a bit too much, isn't it, really? Right then. Where were we? Shall we start again? Right, let's have a look at this one first. Oh, we've actually got some... Now, luckily, this is laminated, so that's come off nicely. It's got a little splash of champagne. I've just drunk it all. I would never have had the problem. Cheer up, folks. It's supposed to be a party. This is a wonderful party. All the best parties have got spilled drinks, broken glasses, you know, little mishaps. Happy accidents. A bit like when we're spraying and, you know, sometimes we don't quite go according to plan. That's my Tattinger plug cork and my champagne cage. Yes, things don't always go to plan, do they? And we have these happy little accidents. Was it Bob Ross that used to say that, wasn't it? But yeah, it's all part of life, isn't it? Drink, celebrate, enjoy good friends, enjoy nostalgia. Somebody wrote to me a couple of days ago and he said about the Matchbox review kits videos, and he was saying how much pleasure they brought him and how he'd just forgotten about many of them, and he'd watched one of my vids and then he was hooked, and then he was watching another and another and another, and he just went through them, you know. And he was saying at the end that he said he'd had days of pleasure watching them because they just took him right back to when he was a kid and his own experiences. And that's what we're trying to do, really. I think most of the time in my vids, it's this is why I don't want to do build vids. It's not that I can't do them, although my actual build environment in terms of spraying is not here. I've said this before. It's not here. It's not in the best possible sort of location. It's in our kitchen, and I spray out the kitchen door, so wouldn't make for good TV at all. But yeah, I don't want to do something that's just the same as what everybody else does, really. I was just trying to do something different. And when I open those Matchbox kits, it just transports me back to being, you know, 7, 8, 9 years old. And I think that it's the same for many of you too. So let's have a look at this. I'm stalling. I'm padding it out because I'm trying to see if it's dried. I've run out of tissue, I think. We have run out of tissue. Let's have a look at this anyway. So we've got the Strike Eagle. Still got a bit of champagne in it. Did I get any champagne on that as well or not? That one escaped. I think that one may have escaped. No, it's not champagne. It's there, really. Let's have a look. So this is the Sam Publications. Nice shot of the Strike Eagle and the Mac Loop in North Wales here. And we've got some wonderful resources here. We've got some really, 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 really interesting data and photographs talking about the origins of the eagle, how they were. Look at the paint job here. This is quite interesting, isn't it? They've sort of given it a sort of phantom-like paint job. See that? It's quite interesting, isn't it? Not quite sure why. Yeah, it's definitely like a phantom, isn't it? Like a Vietnam style paint job, really. This is when they're developing the Strike Eagle from the Standard Eagle and the C to the E, via the D, of course. And then we've got just, it's very heavily loaded, this particular book. It's all photographs, you know, with minimal text, really, because it's to be a resource for the modeller. And you've got your Lakenheath Strike Eagles there. Lots of Lakenheath shots. Alaskan ones. Yeah. Well, lovely photos as well. excellent photography. I did see a photograph a couple of days ago where there was a shot of a Lakenheath Strike Eagle that had got, I don't know if you've seen this, but it's got sparks coming out of its engine, actually in flight, not landing, but in going over, and it's got huge clouds of sparks, not afterburner, actual sparks from its starboard engine. It looked like there'd been some, like a, I don't know, a compressor blade had gone wrong or something in the engine. One of the axial flow blades had gone, and I think it was on the point of failure, but I'm sure they got it back okay. Anyway, you've got the Alaskan Eagles, you've got Seymour Johnson ones. Look at this, some really good shots. Very good for your weathering data here. Look at that. Wow. Now then, that is a very interesting. You can see the APU, and you can see all the burn marks either side of the APU exhaust port there, here, both sides, yeah. APU in the middle. Remarkable. I've got some really good footage here, really good photos, I should say. Onboard shots. We've got some of the talking about the future of the F-15SE, and of course they've got the EX now, which is going to have built in as part of the conformal fuel tanks area. They're going to use that as like a missile pod, a bit like the F-35, where the missile will pop out, so it'll be more stealthy and it can carry more more of a payload in terms of rockets and air-to-air missiles, etc. In the Gulf War here, with the burning refineries flying over the Kuwaiti oil wells that are on fire. Wow, I mean, it just goes on and on and on with so many beautiful photos. Fantastic references. You've got walk around here. Really nice walk round, and yes, it gets into a lot of detail. They said, see the onboard screens here for the pilot and the wizard in the back. Fortunately, they're not switched on. Fortunate. And then you've got all the detail around the cockpit and canopy. And I use this book actually as a reference, especially like here around the ejector seats here. The oxygen bottles and things, and I use that as a reference for my model. And you've got your 20mm cannon here being stripped away for maintenance, and then you've got your F100 engine exhaust nozzles, and here's those actuator rods that we talked about in the Revell kit, which was very, very problematic indeed. And then you've got all the different remembering 9/11, all the different artworks that we used. Some very interesting ones as well. This one down here, they're using the 11. It's the Twin Towers, of course. See that? Yeah. Very, very interesting. Thought-provoking. Look at that, they're actually removing or installing one of the conformal fuel tanks. Look, that's amazing. And I think the Strike Eagle first flew, the Strike Eagle, the F-15E, first flew in 86, I think it was, they actually started testing this variant. And they're showing here various weapons being tested, different loadouts, the Israeli versions here. Yeah, the Israeli ones are in this typical sort of more deserty style camouflage, aren't they? More appropriate for their theatre. The runway arrestor hook here, which often they get used more often than you might imagine in emergencies. And various artworks with eagles on the tail. Saudi Arabia, of course, have got the S version that they bought. I mean, they've sold so widely, haven't they, these? Korea have got them, Israel's got them, Saudi's got them. Who else? Oman, is it? Other countries. Japan, of course, Japanese. Singapore, the SG version. It's going into all these variants, isn't it? The K, Korean, Slam Eagle. There we go. What was I just saying? And this is what's good about the book. It's going into all these different versions. It doesn't show the Japanese. There's the Japanese, I don't think, use the E so much, do they? They're more obsessed with sort of... Obsessed is too strong a word, but they're very focused on defence, aren't they? So it's air defence. They're more into the C variant. Oh, I think they call it the J, don't they, for obvious reason. Okay. Well, there we go. Well, we've learned the lesson here today, and that's if you put the Tettinger on here, you can get into all sorts of trouble. I'm sure that my light's got all very sticky now. To have another little wipe because I can see that the light has got champagne all over it and it's not looking too good. Well, what else have we got to do on a Monday evening, eh? Watch me doing a bit of cleaning. Let's get that off. That light does not want champagne all over it, that is for sure. It's sort of still everywhere. Trouble is, it's so sticky, isn't it? You know. That said, the better quality champagnes like Tettinger are not that sticky because they're not as much sugar in them. It's more, they're trying to focus on the more natural ingredients, really. Trying to make sure we haven't missed any glass, and I think there is a bit of glass here still. I'm a little bit preoccupied with that. I'm walking down here with bare feet and getting a lot of champagne glass in foot. Excuse me for a moment, folks. I just want to do another double check on the kit. Did it really escape? I can't believe. There it is. The kit was right in the trajectory of the champagne. And do you know what? It's just about 3 inches clear of all the spray that came down. It's absolutely fine. There's nothing. That is just... very, very fortunate. I'm going to do it. Pop that out there. As soon as you introduce alcohol, it's dangerous, isn't it? I mean, I was going to be smoking my cigar as well. And having a really, you know, celebratory time. Quoting Will Smith from... well, perhaps he's not a good person to quote at the moment because he rather blotted his copybook, didn't he, recently? But anyway, but because it was from Independence Day, I only smoke the cigar when the fat lady sings, you know. Well, I was like that today. I was waiting for this Saturday lunchtime. I was waiting to get the millionth view. And I went on there and there were 999,998 views. And then it just suddenly went to 1,000,001, as you saw. So yeah, it's been quite an enjoyable experience, really. Not as enjoyable as the champagne, though. I should have put some ice in it, I think. Anyway, which are your favourite Strike Eagle kits? Because there's a few decent ones, aren't there? The Academy did a decent one. Great Wall Hobbies is probably the best in both scales. 72nd and 48th. But I tell you, that new Revell one is quite nice, to be honest. It is quite a big leap forward for them, especially. I'm going to put that out of trouble, out of the way down there, so we can't have any more accidents. Just going to make sure my hands are clean and let them get dry before we get the next book out. Because we need to have a look at this one as well, I think. Do you like my flags? They're bought from the same supply, but for some reason the American flag, the Stars and Stripes, is a little bit smaller. I've no idea why. And they've also got different sort of different style to the... that's very American, though. I thought it was actually quite good, the way they did this... see the top of it? It's I think that looks really very presidential, you know. But the British one's sort of slightly different style. It's got like a gold top to it. So I think they're thinking about the Queen's Jubilee, perhaps, or even though it's platinum. But they're just in a slightly different style. I'm not quite sure why. Anyway, we will have this now moved over here. Out of the way. Thank you very much. And we'll have a look at the F-15 Eagle book. Is that got a mark on it? Or is that not? I think this one is quite as well protected as the other ones. No, don't think so. Again, we're going to have more of the same, I think, with this book. It's bigger. There's a lot more of it. I mean, actually, for £8, it seems really good value. And there's some quite interesting different elements to it in terms of the content. So let's have the lights on over here. Let's see what we've got. And here we are. Oh, yes. ZZ. Where's that then? Come on. American Cousins, where's ZZ? Where's that? I've never seen that insignia before. Those are C's, obviously. So this is not just this is all Eagles. And it really does, it's really nice, this book, because it starts talking about the history of aviation and the early beginnings, you know, and how we've got to where we are today with the Raptor as well. So we've got some F-22 Raptors there. I've just decided I need to move this. I'm a little bit worried that my kit's about to be the next victim. Off the end of that table. Right. Better. Yeah. We can continue. So we've got the history of flight, we've got the Spitfire. Look at that. Beautiful marble Spitfire. We've got the Sopwith Camel. All sorts of things. B2s, and you've just basically got the ME109E, I think that is. Some really nice historical pictures. The Mustang, of course, that's a natural sort of ancestor for the Eagle, isn't it? Zero, Messerschmitt 262. And then, of course, the North American Sabre, which again is another forerunner, isn't it? The first jet fighter that Americans had in numbers. By the way, one of these Sabres actually passed over my house on Sunday afternoon. There was an air show on the northwest coast of England at Southport, seaside town. And one of these Sabres went zooming over the top. And again, it was just so fast that I literally looked up and said, Sabre. I knew it was a Sabre straight away, but there was no chance of getting a camera anywhere near it, and it was long gone, you know. And he was doing about 400 knots, I reckon, maybe more, 500 knots even. And he wasn't very high, he was only at about 2,000-3,000 feet, if that. But they're a nice looking aeroplane, the Sabre, aren't they? He's talking about the lessons of air superiority, or lessons learned in the Korean War with the MiGs versus the Sabres. And then it goes off into lots of detail talking about the Raptor, and then of course the fledgling early F-15, which of course replaced the F-4 Phantom as a multi-role aircraft and air superiority fighter. Robert McNamara, look, wasn't he pushing the F-111? I seem to remember. The F-111 was absolutely enormous, wasn't it? It was a big plane, you know. It's about 30% bigger than the Phantom. Big aircraft. Shows it there, can you see that? Zoom in. There we go. Everything's gone a little astray this afternoon. My watch is now going round the corner. What's going on here? Sorry about this, just having a little bit of technical trouble. See, my watch has just strayed around my wrist. Oh yeah, MiG-25. Well, of course, I have a nice kit of that. I built the ICM 76 scale version, and that was done at New Year time. MiG-23. Of course, that was the natural dogfighting opponents for the F-15. And then you've got all these different, it goes into a lot of detail on this. I think this is really excellent value for money. This, I'm going to say book, but it's almost a magazine really. But it's talking about how they developed the cannons, a need for a gun on the Phantom, of course, which was stupidly designed without a gun. So they brought out the Vulcan cannon, or the M61 Gatling gun, as it's known. Obviously on the Eagle they brought out the 20mm General Dynamics cannon, which was in the shoulder of the leading edge on the starboard side. And then there's all these pictures of the prototype Eagle. Look at that. Into service. Wow. And then it really goes off into the details of what makes the Eagle so special. The Streak Eagle, flying the Eagle as a fighter. Its performance against contemporary Soviet aircraft like the Flanker family. It's a Ukrainian one now, actually, isn't it? Well, they're allies now, of course. They're really having their own trouble, aren't they? Struggling a little bit. Then we've got sort of a breakdown here. Whoops. Breakdown of the exploded view, cross-sectional view of the actual aircraft, and then the export Eagles. So then we start with the Israeli one and the Japanese version. Is that the ZZ? It's the Japanese, is it? I think it is, isn't it? And then you've got the bomber, the F-15E, building the Beagle. The F-15E striking. What a great photograph that is. That's a super picture, isn't it? Look at that. Wow. That's in the Mac loop, I'm sure of it. Yep. All about the F-15 Strike Eagle. And the Lakenheath, got the Lakenheath aeroplanes, they have the LN on the tail, look. And again, exploded view of the F-15E striking. And then it goes off into the various details of the Israeli ones. Ones used in the Gulf War, tackling the MiG-25s. Of course, they were no match for the Eagle at all. And of course, Eagle undefeated factor fetching. Well, the reality is that the Eagle was, the same story as the Sea Harrier for the British Royal Navy Air Service. Neither of them, those aircraft, were shot down in air-to-air combat. They'd been hit by ground fire, brought down by ground fire, but none of them were knocked down by another plane. Same with the Sea Harrier. So it's quite an enviable reputation. And then there's the story, which is quite a famous one. There's a very famous video on YouTube about this, about the Israeli Eagle that came back on with just one wing, the one shot away. Absolutely unbelievable, really. You know, this aircraft could continue flying with just nothing but the wing root left. Absolutely incredible. Look at it. Let's get closer in a bit for you. This is truly remarkable. Look at the photograph on the extreme right. That's all there was, that bit of wing root left. The wing was just gone, and he managed to land that plane. What an incredible pilot as well. Ziv Nedivi and his navigator, I think they were just astonished. They're saying that they made a slightly faster approach, 250 knots, because they didn't want the speed to drop, because they're just not going to be lift at low speed. So they put the emergency arrestor hook down, engaged the cable, which he took about a third of the way down the runway. The hook itself tore off the aircraft, and eventually I stopped 20 feet short of the barrier at the very end of the runway. That is remarkable. Absolutely astonishing stuff. Wow. And then they're talking about Eagle versus Raptor here, how it compares to the new aircraft. Well, of course, in terms of absolute performance, it compares very favourably. It's just that it doesn't have the stealth capability. And it talks about the Strike Eagle here. Another shot of it in North Wales on the top left there. Can clearly see that's the Mac loop. And of course this is sold all over the world, and it's such a good platform is the Eagle that it was going to be mothballed around about, they said 2025, look, the F-15 today. Some incredible footage here, and they talk about the F-15, the future of it. Of course they're talking there about the Silent Eagle with having weapons bay, SE. But of course it's now the XE, they're calling it the XE, aren't they? And that's going to be developed, the SA, then the SE, and now the XE, EX, sorry. Wow, it's all there, isn't it? That's a really, really, really good publication. And as I say, I am thinking about giving this up along with the 72nd scaled kit. I would like your input, what to do, whether I should donate it to charity or sell it on eBay and just donate the funds to charity. Your call. If anybody would like to make me an offer for it and buy it directly from me, and I'll give the money to charity, that's fine as well. So if any of you say, well, I'd like that one and that book, you know, I'm thinking of offers above £25. I think that'd be a bargain for the pair. I mean, we know it's worth at least £38-40, depending on where you buy it from. I mean, it's £40 including postage wherever you buy it from, frankly, pretty much, to get that book and that kit. So bear that in mind. He says, bringing it back and check it, it's not got champagne in it, did I? Yes, I did. Like my little bit of blue tack. It's got a slightly strange shape to it, so we have a little bit of blue tack that goes underneath. There we go. So, there we have it. Anyway, I've gone rambling on about all sorts of different things. I've talked about alcohol, I've talked about cigars. I've talked about photography, all manner of subjects really that were not really on the original agenda. That go there? Yes, it will. And I've spilled alcohol all over the place, more to the point I've broken glass and I've spilled sugary champagne everywhere. But we seem to get away with it, didn't we? I hope you've enjoyed it. Really just wanted to have a very relaxed sort of evening video this time. Just to say thank you to everybody, really. I have achieved my goal, if you like, of 1 million views on YouTube. And it's a very worthy video, in fairness. It's not me rambling on, it's just 3.5 minutes of full-on afterburner, full afterburner action, full sound. You can almost feel these aircraft taking off. So I shall put the link over here of that video. And maybe one or two of the other ones will have a link here, and have another one down there as well. Probably do a link to this review actually, so you can see it in more detail. Please come back to me. It doesn't matter if you're not on live chat. Please come back to me in the comments what you would like me to do with these two, because I'm prepared to give these up to a worthy cause. Either somebody wants to buy them directly from me, or I can put them on eBay, or failing that, somebody wants to appeal to my better nature, one of you who've been a big assistance to me this year, by all means, I'll consider you. You will have to kneel before the king, though, because I've got 1 million views on YouTube now and you're just peasants. Stop that. No, sorry, I'm not. Who do I think I am? No, I'm not. Shut up. I'm getting carried away with my own sense of self-importance there. No, I'm just having a bit of fun. As I said, a lot of that video was, yes, I did a good job of it. I think I did a very good job of it. But I was also in the right place at the right time, and everything aligned. I was very lucky, very lucky. And I just made the most of that opportunity, really. So, there we go. So, 1 million views on YouTube. Please go and watch the video. You'll enjoy it. I hope you found it interesting. And talking about Strike Eagles and talking about our great buddies in the 48th Fighter Wing, the Liberty Wing, based at Lakenheath in Suffolk, just northwest of Thetford, near Brandon. And we are very grateful to them, I'm sure, for continuing to support the UK and NATO and all liberty loving people around the world, including Ukraine. So thank you very much, guys, down in Lakenheath. We really appreciate your input. I hope you watch this. I must try and put a hook in to make sure that people at Lakenheath who go on YouTube get this as a prompt to maybe have a look. Do have a look at the actual video that got the million views. It's worth 3 minutes of your time, of anybody's time. And as I say, tell me what you want me to do with these. They are up for offer. I'll accept any offer. I'd kind of like to go to charity, maybe a Ukraine charity at the moment. See what we can do there, perhaps help them a bit more. But if anybody wants to buy it directly, putting it on eBay is such a pain. That's just such a lot of hard work. So if anybody comes to me directly and says, look, I'll give you £30-35, and I will then give that money to Disasters Emergency Committee, DEC for Ukraine, as per the last one, or one of the other Ukraine charities. But I will certainly listen. If any of you have got United States Air Force charities that you would like it to be, you know, you want to buy it and I'll donate the money to them, that's fine, no problem. Just like it to go to a good home and maybe support a good cause. So thank you very much for watching. I gave my own video 10 out of 10, but I would say that, wouldn't I? Let's hope you agree and give me 10 out of 10 with a thumbs up for this vid. Hope you found it entertaining. Been on for quite a while. How long have I been on for now? Been on for a while, yeah, been on for quite a long time. Hope I've passed a very hot, sweaty evening. Hope you've enjoyed a bit of a drink and you didn't spill yours and smash the glass like I did. I think it's always good to have a bit of entertainment, isn't it? Something unpredictable. I bet some of you, and I know certain usual suspects, must be howling. I can imagine what the comments you're writing are. I'll see those in the live chat, of course, when this goes out live. I think you'll be having a right laugh at my expense, which is absolutely fine. I can take it. I'm a big boy, and I've had a great time. I've had a great result with my video. Thank you all for watching that. Please watch it again as many times as you like. But we reached our goal. We got to the million. I believe YouTube normally send you a certificate. I think if you get a million subscribers, and if you get 100,000 subscribers, or a million, or if you get a million views, I think they send you a certificate normally. So I hope that's the case. I'd enjoy that, and if I got that, I'd put it up here so you can see it for the future. I think that'd be quite nice for you to enjoy as well. Anyway, thank you very much, all of you, for watching this video and for watching the one that's been very popular. I hope you'll all take care of yourselves, especially in this extreme heat that we're having in the UK and Northern Europe. Well, most of Europe, really. And I know some of you in the States are having some problems with it too. Keep hydrated, keep out the sun, you know, take care of yourselves. Very, very hot conditions, unusual. So please look after yourselves above all else, because I'd like you to come back and visit me again, support the channel, and we'd like to chat with you again too, very soon. In the meantime, thank you very much for joining me. All your time is much appreciated. Take care of yourselves, and bye for now.